Good morning and welcome to worship. I'm Pastor Terry Peterson from St. John's in Elkhart, and Father Joshua Nelson is on vacation today. I also have with me Deacons Clay Berkeley and Melissa Renner. Let's take a moment to prepare our hearts for worship with some silence. Grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.
Let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed. By what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your name. Amen.
Almighty God, have mercy on us, forgive us all our sins through our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen us in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep us in eternal life.
Amen.
Lord, open our lips.
And our mouths shall proclaim your praise.
Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen. Alleluia. The earth is the Lord's, for he made it.
Come, let us adore him.
Come, let us sing to the Lord. Let us shout for joy to the rock of our salvation. Let us come before his presence with thanksgiving and raise a loud shout to him with psalms. For the Lord is a great God and a great King above all gods. In his hand are the caverns of the earth, and the heights of the hills are also his. The sea is his, for he made it, and his hands have molded the dry land. Come, let us bow down and bend the knee and kneel before the Lord our Maker. For he is our God, and we are the people of his pasture and the sheep of his hand. Oh, that today you would hearken to his voice. The earth is the Lord's, for he made it.
Come, let us adore him.
Psalm today is Psalm 13. How long, O Lord, will you forget me forever? How long will you hide your face from me? How long shall I have perplexity in my mind and grief in my heart day after day? How long shall my enemy triumph over me? Look upon me and answer me, O Lord my God. Give light to my eyes, lest I sleep in death. Lest my enemy say, I have prevailed over him, and my foes rejoice that I have fallen. But I put my trust in your mercy. My heart is joyful because of your saving help. I will sing to the Lord, for he has dealt with me richly. I will praise the name of the Lord Most High. A reading from the book of Genesis. After these things, God tested Abraham. He said to him, Abraham, and he said, Here I am. He said, Take your son, your only son Isaac, whom you love, and go to the land of Moriah, and offer him there as a burnt offering on one of the mountains that I will show you. So Abraham rose early in the morning, saddled his donkey, and took two of his young men with him, and his son Isaac. He cut the wood for the burnt offering, and set out and went up to the place in the distance that God had shown him. On the third day, Abraham looked up and saw the place far away. Then Abraham said to his young men, Stay here with the donkey. The boy and I will go over there. We will worship, and then we will come back to you. Abraham took the wood of the burnt offering and laid it on his son Isaac, and he himself carried the fire and the knife. So the two of them walked on together. Isaac said to his father Abraham, Father, and he said, Here I am, my son. He said, The fire and the wood are here, but where is the lamb for a burnt offering? Abraham said, God himself will provide the lamb for a burnt offering, my son. So the two of them walked on together. When they came to the place that God had shown him, Abraham built an altar there and laid the wood in order. He bound his son Isaac and laid him on the altar on top of the wood. Then Abraham reached out his hand and took the knife to kill his son. But the angel of the Lord called to him from heaven and said, Abraham, Abraham. And he said, Here I am. He said, Do not lay your hand on the boy or do anything to him. For now I know that you fear God, since you have not withheld your son, your only son, from me. And Abraham looked up and saw a ram caught in a thicket by its horns. Abraham went and took the ram and offered it up as a burnt offering instead of his son. So Abraham called that place, The Lord will provide. As it is said to this day, on the mount of the Lord it shall be provided. Here ends the reading.
Canticle 16. Blessed be the Lord, the God of Israel. He has come to his people and set them free. He has raised up for us a mighty Savior, born of the house of his servant David. Through his holy prophets, he promised of old that he would save us from our enemies, from the hands of all who hate us. He promised to show mercy to our fathers and to remember his holy covenant. This was the oath he swore to our father Abraham, to set us free from the hands of our enemies. Free to worship him without fear, holy and righteous in his sight, all the days of our life. You, my child, shall be called the prophet of the Most High, for you will go before the Lord to prepare his way, to give his people knowledge of salvation by the forgiveness of their sins. In the tender compassion of our God, the dawn from on high shall break upon us, to shine on those who dwell in darkness and the shadow of death, and to guide our feet into the way of peace. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen.
A reading from the letter of Paul to the Romans. Therefore, do not let sin exercise dominion in your mortal bodies to make you obey their passions. No longer present your members to sin as instruments of wickedness, but present yourself to God as those who have been brought from death to life, and present your members to God as instruments of righteousness. For sin will have no dominion over you, since you are not under law, but under grace. What then? Should we sin because we are not under law, but under grace? By no means. Do you not know that if you present yourselves to anyone as obedient slaves, you are slaves of the one whom you obey, either of sin, which leads to death, or of obedience, which leads to righteousness? But thanks be to God that you, having once been slaves of sin, have become obedient from the heart to the form of teaching to which you were entrusted, and that you, having been set free from sin, have become slaves of righteousness. I am speaking in human terms because of your natural limitations. For just as you once presented your members as slaves to impurity and to greater and greater iniquity, so now present your members as slaves to righteousness for sanctification. When you were slaves of sin, you were freed in regard to righteousness. So what advantage did you get from the things of which you are now ashamed? The end of those things is death. But now that you have been freed from sin and enslaved to God, the advantage you get is sanctification. The end is eternal life, for the wages of sin is death, but the free gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. Here ends the reading.
Canticle 21. You are God, we praise you. You are the Lord, we acclaim you. You are the eternal Father, all creation worships you. To you, all angels, all the powers of heaven, cherubim and seraphim, sing in endless praise. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. The glorious company of apostles praise you. The noble fellowship of prophets praise you. The white-robed army of martyrs praise you. Throughout the world, the Holy Church acclaims you. Father of majesty unbounded, your true and only Son, worthy of all worship, and the Holy Spirit, advocate and guide. You, Christ, are the King of glory, the eternal Son of the Father. When you became man to set us free, you did not shun the Virgin's womb. You overcame the sting of death and opened the kingdom of heaven to all believers. You are seated at God's right hand in glory. We believe that you will come and be our judge. Come then, Lord, and help your people, bought with the price of your own blood, and bring us with your saints to glory everlasting.
The Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Matthew. Whoever welcomes you welcomes me, and whoever welcomes me welcomes the one who sent me. Whoever welcomes a prophet in the name of a prophet will receive a prophet's reward, and whoever welcomes a righteous person in the name of a righteous person will receive the reward of the righteous. And whoever gives even a cup of cold water to one of these little ones in the name of a disciple, truly I tell you, none of these will lose their reward. Here ends the reading.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. As we prepare for sermons, the Holy Spirit hopefully is involved in that, but then also the Holy Spirit can move between the time you write and the time you preach. So this morning, as I was listening to that first reading with Isaac and Abraham, I thought, you know, this is such an important scripture that I want to just say a few words before I get back to my what I've already written. But, you know, in our sensibilities today, we hear this reading of Abraham tying his son up and pulling out a knife, you know, and how that just is horrific. We would, you know, how traumatic that would be for his son. And I'm sure in some ways it was very much, but in that time of Abraham and Isaac, child sacrifice was pretty prominent in the other religions. And so having this setting wouldn't have been shocking at the time. And if you picture Isaac as a strapping young man, as opposed to a small child, it changes the picture a little bit that he is willingly going with his older father that he could escape from, and willingly allows this to happen. But the most important part of that is that the Lord interrupts it and says, this is not the way this religion will be. We're not going to do child sacrifice here. This is not appropriate. But then also this story is about a father and his only son. Now, he did have another son, Ishmael, but Ishmael's out of the picture at the moment. So this is his only son, and his name is Father of Many. And he is willing to sacrifice that son. God says no, but then Jesus, God's only son, is sacrificed for everyone. So I just wanted to shed a little light on that, because it is such a scary story, I think, for us right now. Rightly so. We, you know, with the prevalence of child abuse and everything, we don't want to sanction it in any way. In the gospel, though, we hear about Jesus saying, whoever welcomes me or welcomes someone else in my name welcomes me. And, you know, this is a scripture that those of us leaders in the church just love. When we're all in church together, we're like, okay, everybody, you have to welcome everybody who comes through that door. It doesn't matter what they look like, if they smell or don't smell, if they look like us or don't look like us, we can just say, okay, everybody is welcome here. And then we will elaborate on that, you know. And we even set up our whole system of getting into worship around that. We have people that welcome others. We have greeters, you know, we have ushers that are supposed to greet the people that come through the door. We invite all of our members during the passing of the peace to introduce themselves to visitors and welcome them. So we have a whole system of how we do this in the church. We're not in the church right now. We're out in the world, and it's a little bit more difficult to think of how we might do this. So think about, you know, we can't welcome them to in-person worship. If we say, okay, we need to be hospitable and talking to people out in the community, that's very difficult even right now when we're wearing masks. I know there's a lot less chatter in stores, you know, because people don't want to talk to each other. They don't want to spread anything. Plus it's hard to hear. And so you don't want to say something and then have to ask somebody to repeat what they said because you couldn't hear them. And so it makes it a little bit difficult. And so we feel a little bit more isolated. And then in doing that, we might turn in on ourselves and not think about the other. But then also in this time, we have online worship. And with online worship, we are welcoming people from we don't know where. There are numbers that show that people are coming that aren't members of our congregations, and or maybe they're members that just haven't been in a while and they haven't been comfortable coming to the church because they've been gone so long, but now they can do it and be comfortable and not worry about people judging them. Or someone who wanted to try out church but didn't feel comfortable going through those doors, and so now they can do that without feeling awkward or strange, learn a little bit about the church online. And so there is a benefit for this right now as well. So we have to keep that in mind. And then to think about how to do this welcoming, this sharing of who Jesus is, this caring for people as who they are. We welcome a prophet as a prophet, a righteous person as a righteous person, an old person as an old person. How do we do that? I'm going to use the E word. How do we evangelize in this time when we don't want to talk to people? How do we witness when we're at home by ourselves? And the first thing, you know, is through social media. That's an obvious one. But if you're not willing to share your story online, which Father Joshua and I did between two priests this past week, you could invite friends and family to come to worship with you, you know, make a watch party and invite others to come to worship with you. You can pay attention to what people post on social media when they're struggling. And if you're close enough to them, call them rather than just deal with them on social media, make that personal connection. I still love to write cards. So, you know, if you're into that and you have time because you're stuck at home, send out a note and let them know that you're praying for them and you care for them. So those are simple ways that we can do that. Another idea, another way to think about welcoming someone as who they are, in this time of Black Lives Matter and protests and this making aware that there's this systematic racism, is to learn about that, is to understand what's going on in the world so that you can welcome someone genuinely rather than from a place of ignorance and or learned behavior that isn't necessarily good. And I'll use an example again of myself. I always, you know, I don't want to point at anybody else, but I'll point at myself. So one of the things I've always done, because I grew up poor in a trailer park and have that, grew up with a particular kind of language, a particular way of behavior, right? So going through college and seminary has sort of worked itself out of me, but I can fall back into that pattern pretty easily. But also I can fall into the pattern of mimicking speech of other people. So if I'm with somebody who is from North Dakota, I might mimic the way they talk. And I have to be very aware that I do this. Because it can be very insulting, right? So if I'm with an African-American and I'm switching into what I think is African-American speak as a white person, that's ridiculous. I didn't grow up in that community. Now, if I had, it might be different, but I didn't. And so I have to be very aware of that. So that learning that, having that knowledge helps me to welcome people from a genuine place rather than from this awkward, weird place of mimicking how I think they behave. So that's one way we can think about it. But another way is just to learn as much as we can about those kinds of behaviors we do without thinking. And we've talked about this through many sermons in the last few weeks, but one thing that came up recently that I'm kind of looking into is listening to podcasts, either about racism or by an African-American, just them talking about their culture or their lives there. So I've been looking into that, and I picked out a couple just to mention because I think it can be daunting if we just go out there and just try and find things, especially if you're not used to listening to podcasts. So they're easiest to listen to either on your computer or your smartphone. You can just go to a website with a podcast and click on listen now on your computer, or you can download those podcasts onto your smartphone. So one of those is, it's kind of a tongue-in-cheek kind of podcast, but it's called Yo, Is This Racist? And basically, people send in questions, call in questions saying, okay, I said this, is it racist? And then the two people that do the podcast talk about that particular phrase or that particular thing and explain why it might or might not be a racist phrase that we just grew up with. So an example of that would be saying an African-American is very well-spoken. That's a phrase that you hear a lot. And we think, well, that's not, you know, a person should be well-spoken. But there's a whole history behind that. And so this podcast would help you learn why some phrases, even though they seem innocent, aren't necessarily innocent there. And then another one is called Groundings. And it's basically a couple of people listening to what's going on in the world today, sharing stories, bringing in other people to share stories. So it's a conversation that brings up things just as they kind of flow into the conversation. So it's a little more relaxed, but a little more serious. So those are a couple, Yo, Is This Racist? And Groundings. But there are a lot of them out there. And you can look for others as well. All of this is to say that we need to, when we're welcoming others, when we're sharing our stories, when we're witnessing, that is to tell people about the good news of Jesus Christ, and that it is for everyone, and that we need to be aware that we don't always share it with everyone. So what is that good news? That good news is God's only Son was sacrificed on the cross. God's only Son died for our sins and for the brokenness of the world, which includes everyone that is born, all of God's children, whether they're in the church already or have yet to come to the church, and letting them know that they are loved in this world and cared for, and that we are all in the same boat of being broken and sinful and in need of forgiveness, that none of us are can have a holier than thou attitude or a more righteous attitude. It's just, I happen to know something that I think would be good for you as well. And come join me in confessing our sins and learning about our salvation through Jesus Christ. So I invite you all to think about your own self, do some self-reflection, and learn about the other, as well as sharing your story. Take a few minutes and talk to your children or grandchildren about how your faith has grown or how you came to faith. It is a really neat thing to share with others and eye-opening. So blessings this week. Amen. Let us confess our faith with the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen.
We use suffrages A this morning. Show us your mercy, O Lord.
And grant us your salvation.
Clothe your ministers with righteousness.
Let your people sing with joy.
Give peace, O Lord, in all the world.
For only in you can we live in safety.
Lord, keep this nation under your care.
And guide us in the way of justice and truth.
Let your way be known upon earth.
Your saving health among all nations.
Let not the needy, O Lord, be forgotten.
Nor the hope of the poor be taken away.
Create in us clean hearts, O God.
And sustain us with your Holy Spirit.
Almighty God, you have built your church upon the foundation of the apostles and prophets, Jesus Christ himself being the chief cornerstone. Grant us so to be joined together in unity of spirit by their teaching. We may be a holy temple acceptable to you through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen.
Amen.
O God, you have made of one blood all the peoples of the earth and sent your blessed Son to preach peace to those who are far off and to those who are near. Grant that the people everywhere may seek after you and find you. Bring the nations into your fold. Pour out your spirit upon all flesh. And hasten the coming of your kingdom through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
Today, we give thanks again for the communities of St. John the Evangelist and St. David of Wales, and for the gift of technology. And we pray for all the medical professionals who are working to see us through these chaotic times. The Anglican Encyclical of Prayer, we pray for the United Church of North India, the Most Reverend Dr. Prem Chand Singh, moderator of the Church of North India, and Bishop of Jabalpur. In the Diocesan Cycle of Prayer, we pray for the following ministries of our diocese: Baptized for Life, Daughters of the King and Renewal Ministries, Brotherhood of St. Andrew, and Episcopal Church Women. I invite your own prayers of intercession or thanksgiving, spoken aloud or in the quiet of your hearts. You may place them in the comments section as well.
For those preparing for surgery and for those recovering from surgery, especially John and Beth.
Pray for all those who work in unsafe circumstances, for first responders and healthcare workers.
We pray also for Kirsten Laurel Guidero.
We remember all of those who have died, especially Richard Osborne, Pauline Polly Schaefer, John Watson, William Riblett, and Virginia Ann Jacka Durst. May their souls and the souls of all the departed through the mercy of God rest in peace.
We pray for all those who are ill or recovering from any type of illness, including those who are suffering from COVID-19. We pray especially for Canon Henry Randolph as he begins to heal from cancer.
Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Almighty God, Father of all mercies, we, your unworthy servants, give you humble thanks for all your goodness and loving kindness to us and to all whom you have made. We bless you for our creation, preservation, and all the blessings of this life, but above all, for your immeasurable love in the redemption of the world by our Lord Jesus Christ, for the means of grace and for the hope of glory. And we pray, give us such an awareness of your mercies that with truly thankful hearts we may show forth your praise, not only with our lips, but in our lives, by giving up ourselves to your service and by walking before you in holiness and righteousness all our days. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, to whom with you and the Holy Spirit be honor and glory throughout all ages. Amen. Let us bless the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Glory to God, whose power working in us can do infinitely more than we can ask or imagine. Glory to him from generation to generation in the church and in Christ Jesus forever and ever. Amen.